Nix Flakes is Nix's experimental feature that enforces a uniform structure for Nix projects. Despite being an experimental feature, Nix Flakes are widely adopted, which often creates confusion for newcomers. I will not go into the details on this topic about when Nix Flakes will be stable or why Nix Flake is not perfect, but instead, in this video, I will show you the basics of Nix Flakes, including how to do hello world with Nix Flakes, how to use flake inputs, how to use flake outputs, how to use experimental Nix commands with Nix Flakes, and how flake changed the way we work with Nix. Please note that what I will show you here is how Nix Flakes work as of the time of recording, and it might change in the future. Now let's get started. So first, since Nix Flake is an experimental feature, you need to explicitly enable it in your Nix configuration. Make sure to enable both Nix command and Flake's experimental features. To enable it once for a single command invocation, you can pass experimental features flake to the command. To enable it permanently, if you use NixOS or Home Manager, you can set it on nix.settings.experimentalfeatures. If you installed Nix using the Determinate Nix installer, you already have it enabled. Otherwise, you can enable it in nix.conf in your system. And just like any other tutorial, let's start with Hello World example. First, enter an empty directory and run Nix Flake in it. After the command finishes, you will see a flake.nix file and flake.lock file. Then you can run nix build.hello. After running the command, you should see a symlink with the name result created in the current directory. The symlink contains a directory with the name bin, and inside the directory, you can see an executable file named hello. Now let's run this file, and if you see hello world on your terminal, you have successfully built a package using Nix Flake. Now before we get into the details of flake.nix and flake.lock files, it might be useful if I tell you that flake.nix and flake.lock share the same functionality as entry point and lock file in other programming languages or package managers. For example, in JavaScript, it's package.json and package.lock.json, and in Rust, it's cargo.toml and cargo.lock. You might be able to make some parallels with the package manager you are familiar with. Now let's take a look at the flake.nix file. On the top level, we can see two attributes, inputs and outputs. As you can guess, inputs define the dependencies of the flake and outputs define the objects that are exported by the flake. Quickly looking at the inputs, it might make sense to you that it has a data type of object, since this is how we usually define dependencies in other package managers. But the outputs here might be a bit confusing at first glance, since it's not a serializable data, but a function. The outputs function here takes an inputs object as an argument and returns another object, which is the actual output. So it might make more sense to you if the function was named makeOutputFromInput, or something like that. More on this later. Now let's deep dive into the inputs attribute. So inputs is where you define the dependencies of your flake. Each input is required to have a URL attribute which specifies where the input is located. Now let's see how we can use these imported input objects in the outputs function. Let's say we have another repository named lorem, and inside its flake.nix file, it exports an object named ipsum, which is a simple string. Inside our repository, we can set lorem as an input, set its URL, and add lorem to the outputs function argument. Then we can use the imported variable ipsum in our repository, and it works just like if it was defined locally. Basically, flake inputs and outputs enable importing and exporting Nix entities between repositories. Now let's take a look at the input attribute in the hello world example. In the inputs, we have a single input named Nix packages, pointing to a GitHub repository with username NixOS and repository name Nix packages. Also, it specifically points to the NixOS unstable branch. This Nix packages repository is a monorepo that contains all the packages packaged by the Nix community. Now, in the outputs function, we can see that we have Nix packages as a function argument. So here we can see that Nix packages.legacypackages.x86-64-linux.hello is used in the outputs function. Just like in other programming languages, we use dot notation to access nested objects. The legacy packages is one of the objects that is exported by Nix packages monorepos flake, which contains all of the packages. Inside the legacy packages, each attribute corresponds to a system type like x86-64-linux. Inside the system type object, we can see a lot of Linux packages, and one of them is the hello package. Then we will export this hello package we just imported as an output on our flake with the same name hello. So what we did here is a simple re-export of a package from Nix packages flakes to our flake, and no processing or modification is done here. By the way, if you are not familiar with Nix, these two codes are equivalent in Nix. Also for your information, legacy in legacy packages here doesn't mean it's old or deprecated or something like that. You can pause the video and read the explanation here. So to summarize, we specify dependencies in the inputs attribute, use them in the outputs function by passing them as arguments, and then we can do whatever we want with these dependencies. Now let's take a look at the output function. As I explained in the previous section, the outputs function takes inputs object as an argument and returns anything we want to export. The exported object here is mainly used in two ways. The first one is to be used as an input in other flake.nix file, as we saw earlier. And the second one is to be consumed by Nix commands. The Nix commands I mean here are the experimental Nix commands, which we enabled in the first section. There are a lot of experimental Nix commands, but let's start with the one we already used, the Nix build command. The Nix build command is used to build the package's output of the flake. The package's output is an object where each attribute corresponds to a system type like x86-64 Linux. Inside the system type, we define a package with the name hello, which is assigned with the hello package from the Nix packages input, as we saw earlier. Let's see what happens when we run nixbuild.hello. The nixbuild command first determines the system type of the current machine. In my case, it's x86-64 Linux. Then the command sees the dot character before the hash symbol. The dot here means current directory, which means we want to build something from flake.nix file in the current directory. The hash symbol is just a separator, and after that we have hello, which is the name of the output we want to build. Combining all this information, the command will build the object at packages.x86-64-linux.hello exported by the outputs function in the flake.nix file in the current working directory. You can apply this pattern to other packages in the packages object. Also, we can specify a default package by naming it default. When you run nix build without any argument, it will search for a flake.nix file in the current directory or closest parent directory, and it will build the default package exported by the flake.nix file. After we build the package, you can find the build result in the result symlink in the current directory. Now that you understand the pattern, let's briefly go through the other attributes in the outputs function. The formatter output specifies the formatter program you want to use for this repository. When you run nixfmt, it will use the formatter to format the entire repository. You can also pass a file as an argument to the command to format only that file. The apps output is used to define an executable you want to run, similar to npm run in JavaScript. In this example, if you run nixrun.hello, it will run the hello program. This makes it easier to build an executable and also run it at the same time with a single command. The dev shell's output is used to define a development shell. When you run nix develop, it will open a shell which includes all the dependencies and environment variables specified without polluting the global environment. One usage of this is if you want to switch between different versions of the same package without using language-specific tools like NVM for Node.js or PyEnv for Python. The checks output is used to define checks or tests for the repository. When you run Nix Flake check, it will build all the packages specified in this check attribute. If any of the package fail to build, the command will fail. Additionally, it will also check whether each flake output is exported with the correct data type. For example, if we export a string as a package output when it's supposed to be a derivation, Nix Flake check command will fail. The NixOS configurations output is used to define a NixOS configuration. When you run NixOS rebuild switch --flake, it will build the NixOS configuration you specified here. So now we understand how to use Nix commands with the flake.nix file. In the examples I showed you, we use dot because we want to use the flake.nix file in the current directory. But actually, we can replace the dot with any URLs that are valid in the inputs attribute. Which means we can build packages, run apps, or enter development environments without having to clone the repository. Another commonly used Nix command is Nix flake update. By default, it will update all the inputs in the flake.lock file. And if you pass the name of the input as an argument, only that input will be updated. How the input is updated depends on how we specify the URL. For example, if we specify a branch name, the commit hash in the flake.lock file will be updated to the latest commit of the branch. But if we specify a commit hash, nothing will be updated. Now let's get back to what I said in the beginning of the video. Let's see how Nix Flakes enforce a uniform structure for Nix projects. So before Nix Flakes, when we wanted to use something from another repository, we had to guess which file and which object in that file was the one we wanted to import. We need to either read the documentation or take some time to read the codes in the repository. Now with Nix Flakes enforcing a uniform structure, we can predict which objects are exported by the repository and infer the data type by looking at the export name. Also, before Nix Flakes, people either used Nix in an impure way by using dependencies from users' global environment, or used Nix in a pure way by doing their own way to pin and update the dependencies. There were third-party tools that did this and it worked well, but of course people wanted a first-party solution for this. So flake inputs and Nix flake commands solve this problem by providing a standard way to pin and update dependencies. So that's it for this video. Like, comment and subscribe for more content. Thank you for watching. I hope you find this video helpful, and the name is Nix Hero.